Let me show you how it begins.
Please.
All right.
The first term is zero. When you see a new number, the next term is zero. So we saw a zero, but it was the first one. So the next term is zero. We have seen a zero before. We saw it 1 minute ago. And when you've seen the number before, the next term is how far back? How long ago was it since you saw it? So we saw it one step back. So the next term is one. So now what's the next term? Have we seen a one before? No. So the next term is zero. Have we seen a zero before? Yes. How long ago? Two steps ago. So the next term is two. We've not seen a two before, right? So we get a zero. And we have seen a zero before. It was two steps ago. And we have seen a two before. It was two steps ago. So we get another two. And we have seen a two before. It was one step ago. Now, for the first time, something really interesting is happening. We have seen a one before, but it was one, two, three, four, five, six steps back. So we get a six. And we haven't seen a six before, obviously. So the next term is a zero. Well, we've seen a zero before, and it was one, two, three, four, five steps back. So we get a five. For the first time, so the next term is a zero again. And then we get a two, and so on. That is Van Eck's sequence. The obvious questions are, what happens? Do we see every number? How fast does it grow? What can we say about it? We keep asking these same questions over and over again, and this always reminds me of a poem by Jeanne Beaumont, which is called Afraid So. And it sort of goes like this. Is it starting to rain? Afraid so. Is this going to hurt? Are we out of coffee? Is the car totaled? Will this leave a scar? And so on. The title is Afraid So. I was thinking, there are so many questions we ask about these sequences. So the poem here would be called Don't Know. What's the next term? Don't know. How fast does it grow? Don't know. Does every number appear?
When someone just comes up with a cool sequence like this and there's all these don't knows, whose job is it to find out, or does it, you know, what happens?
Well, this is one of the great things about being an editor of the OEIS. This sequence came in, it was a submission, and one of the pleasures, the editors don't get paid, but they do get to see these sequences when they come in for the first time. And so you look at them, you say, boy, that's a really great sequence. I'm going to analyze that before somebody else does.
You see so many sequences, Neil. Why does this one make you smile like that?
Yeah, I think it's lovely. Well, partly because it's really quite unpredictable. And so, of course, one of the first things you do is you look at the graph. Let me see if I can give you a sketch. So there's a zero and a zero and a one and a zero and a two. But basically what happens, it goes, and then it drops down to zero, and it grows, and so on. And if you look at a lot of terms, it tends to look a bit like this. If you close your eyes and squint, it sort of fills up a whole triangle. It seems that it's growing about linearly. If you look at this line that goes through the top, it seems to have slope one. In other words, the nth term is about n. But we can't prove that. That's one of the many things we can't prove about this. There is one thing we can prove. It keeps growing. It could be that after a while, we don't see any new numbers. There are no more zeros. If the maximum number that ever appeared was 100, then after we see 100, there won't be any more zeros because there won't be any more new numbers. And the argument is very, very pretty. You say, suppose there's some number, let's call it M, maybe it's 100 or maybe it's a million, which is the maximum number that appears ever in this sequence. Now what that would mean is, since the sequence is defined by how far back you look for the last term, that if the biggest number is, say, 100, you would never have to look back more than 100 terms in order to know the complete history from that point on. Everything would be determined. But then you say, if we only have to look back M terms, or m plus 1 terms, and each of those terms is in the range 1 to m, then there would only be m to the m possible terms. Supposing that there is a biggest number, m. We look at a chunk of length m, that determines everything from that point on. But then you say, there are only m to the m different chunks, so one of them will have to repeat, so the sequence will be periodic. So from a certain point on, the sequence will repeat. But that can't happen. You want to see the proof? I think it's quite nice. So here's the sequence. And this part is the period, and then it repeats. From then on, it just keeps repeating over and over again. And let me prove that can't happen. Let's look at this chunk. Say it begins with X, dot, 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 and it ends with Z. And the next period, it's the same thing. It just repeats X to Z, and so on. There might be other copies of Z in the period. So let's look at the first time we see a Z. So this is the first copy of Z in the period. And let's look at the term that comes after it. And let's call it A. Now what that means is, by the rule, the definition of the sequence, is that this A means the last time we saw this Z was A steps back. That's what this A means. Okay, now let's move to the previous period. So we have the Z and we have the A. It's exactly the same as this. But this A means that this Z actually appeared A steps back, so it was here. So that means the period didn't begin there, the first period. It began one step earlier, which is a contradiction. So that can't happen. So the sequence keeps growing. And that's about the only thing we know about it.
There's no maximum number.
That we know for sure. There's no maximum number. There are more and more zeros. Beyond that, we know almost nothing. And there are a number of other questions I should mention. I mean, for instance, does every number appear? Don't know.
Okay, folks, here's one for you. How many ways can you arrange plus and minus signs between these numbers and get a result that's divisible by 3? This is just one of the many daily challenges from Brilliant, and it comes with plenty more interesting chat and discussion, as you can see here. In fact, all the daily challenges are great. I really like this recent one about bikes and tracks. Check it out. Brilliant, of course, have sponsored today's episode. They're great supporters of Numberphile, and their collection of challenges, quizzes, and courses online, you can see them here, they're just fantastic. There's plenty of cool free stuff to check out, but also their premium subscription gives you access to everything. You can get 20% off that subscription by going to brilliant.org/numberphile. And make sure you check out those daily challenges. You can even binge on all the previous ones. It's kind of like a mathematical box set.
You. The thing that happens in your brain when you read a number that you're familiar with is different to what happens when you read a number that you are unfamiliar with.